Sandy VCAL PD presents Movie Talk Podcast.
Hello, welcome to the 2Sweet Movie Show. It's Thursday, the 18th of October. Now, I wanted to talk about some exciting releases. Now, I remember last week I did talk about lots of interesting ones. But yeah, obviously it's Thursday. There's been some more exciting releases which have came out. And I remember last week I did talk about Venom. But why don't we talk about A Star Is Born? Now that actually came out today. And it was very popular last night because I happened to be at Southland and they had the girls' night out screening there. And no, I didn't join in, but I saw that it was sold out, so it's a massive hit between that type of audience, maybe like mums, you know, it's that type of audience. Just like Girls' Night Out and everything. Actually, it's like, it is Girls' Night Out, but I think they call it Flicks with the Chicks. And that's what it was called. They've had many events for I Feel Pretty as well. I remember I was there. I saw the crowds and everything. So, you know, it's all right.
Maybe it's time to let the old ways die. Takes a lot to change, man. Hell, it takes a lot to try.
Can I ask you a personal question?
Okay.
Tell me something, girl.
Do you write songs or anything?
I don't sing my own songs.
Why?
Almost every single person has told me they liked the way I sounded, but that they didn't like the way I look.
I think you're beautiful.
I'm falling.
Hey.
What?
I just want to take another look at you.
In all the good times, I find myself longing for change.
Here's what we're going to do.
We come sing that song that I love.
No, I can't do that.
Look at me.
All you got to do is trust me.
So the story about this film, apparently Bradley Cooper plays a musician and he basically helps a young singer find fame, who is Lady Gaga. And even his age and alcoholism send his own career into a downward spiral. He basically falls in love with her, Lady Gaga. And then there's all this big drama too, so. And it's quite interesting because Bradley Cooper's actually directing. So he's the director for this one. I'm not sure if he's actually directed something. I'm trying to have a look. No, it's actually his directorial debut. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. And I think, oh yeah, he's actually a part of the screenplay as well of A Star Is Born. Not sure if he's written something before. No, it's his screenplay debut as well. And Eric Ross also on board in the screenplay. I think he's done a couple of interesting things over the years. He actually wrote the screenplay for Forrest Gump, The Curious Case of Benjamin Button, The Good Shepherd, or Ali, the one with Will Smith playing Muhammad Ali. And apparently also interesting fact, it's based on the 1976 screenplay by Frank Person. So quite interesting. And I'm not sure, are they the two names which really stand out? I'm pretty sure we don't really see any other memorable names. It's basically just the Bradley Cooper and Lady Gaga show. But the next character after him, Sam Elliott, he plays Bobby. He has been in some memorable things over the years, but I don't think he's been doing many things recently. I don't remember seeing him. He's worked on shows like Parks and Recreation, American Dad, Justified, even the movie The Big Lebowski, Roadhouse, I think that had Patrick Swayze, Up in the Air, Hulk, and Ghost Rider. So, it's been a couple of things, but I don't really remember him. And you've also got Rafi Gavron. I have never heard of him before. I think he's not really a popular actor. But actually, he's an English actor, and he has worked on Snitch with Dwayne Johnson. I think I actually remember him now. He played Dwayne Johnson's son in that film. And it was all about drugs and everything. Yeah, I do remember that one. And Anthony Ramos plays Ramon. Not sure about him either, but he's going to be in the new Godzilla, King of Monsters. So we'll get to see him again. And he's been in the Stand series, Bill and Grace. You've also got De Niro, which must be, Robert De Niro's daughter. And she actually starred in The Intern. She played a hotel manager, or she played Cindy in Joy. I haven't really seen much of her. Well, I did see The Intern, so don't really remember her, though. And actually, Alec Baldwin's in here too. You know, he's in those ads in Australia now. And, you know, he's been on... Oh, yeah, his most recent thing would be Mission Impossible Fallout, where he had a minor role. He wasn't the main character, but he had a bit of a role there, just continuing his role from Rogue Nation. And he was in Black KK Landsman, which I did not see. But apparently it's still out, so that's surprising. It feels like it's been out for about 6-7 weeks. It's pretty crazy. And he's been in Will and Grace and The Departed. Another memorable name, you've got Dave Chappelle. He's a comedian, so I think he does those stand-up specials. I have heard of his name before. He's worked in a couple of things. Pretty surprising to see... Dave Chappelle in here. I just don't really know much about him, to be honest. But I don't think I've ever watched his stand-up specials. He may have been on TV a couple of times over in Australia, but I don't actually remember. I'm just trying to think about it, actually. But, like, I had a feeling it might have been. Yeah, so that's basically A Star Is Born. That's the story of A Star Is Born. Now let's go over to the audience. And now it just came out in Australia, but I think it's been out a while in some other countries like America and some other things like that. So what are the audience's opinions on here? The first one I've got is a 10-star review from Silverback. He says, "This old Marine thoughts." He says that I did not want to watch this movie, but I took my wife to see it because we both saw the one with Chris Christopherson and Barbara Streisand growing up. The crowd was a lot older than we were. We were almost 50. It was the biggest screen they had at our theatre, and seats a lot, but it was maybe half full on Sunday afternoon. not one dry eye in the place. It had a great tempo, didn't drag on, have any lulls in the story. We were both very pleased and are still engaging in conversations about the movie. It's my opinion to highly recommend everyone go out and watch a great movie and a heartfelt movie that redefines love in this time and age we live in. That is my two cents. Hope you enjoy as much as we have. So there you go, that review. He basically think it's one of the best things. He gave it a 10 out of 10. And here's another 10 out of 10. You've got Ventura Spiros. He said, 10 out of 10, A Star Is Born, a magnificent movie, captivating performances by Bradley Cooper and Lady Gaga. The ultimate shock was how brilliant Lady Gaga was. We knew she could sing, but didn't have any idea just how far her acting talent stretches. After watching that, I can tell you, it stretches far enough to earn her some Oscar gold. The movie's outstanding, the music is annoyingly perfect, the cast is great, and everything shouts Oscar-worthy movie. 10 out of 10. And NKBTW has said, an instant classic, Bradley Cooper and Lady Gaga collaboration on this remake of the classic A Star Is Born results in an outstanding movie and the soundtrack that keeps you looking for more until the very end of the movie. Another review, you've got 8 stars out of 10. Bland Byrne has said, a love story mixed with pain, addiction, fame and tragedy. Oh, me being a film buff, I never watched the older takes of A Star Is Born. However, I watched this latest modern spin with Bradley Cooper and Lady Gaga, who have great on-screen chemistry together. The film is a joy as it touches your emotions and grows on you. From the love of the two central characters and the pain combined with fame and sorrow make this musical drama, and the songs are also uplifting, a wonderful watch. Jackson Maine is the main character, which is played by Bradley Cooper. He's basically a hard-living and a hard whiskey-drinking Western rock singer who lives it up, entertaining crowd after crowd. Jackson is a man who's got plenty of personal demons besides the bottle, as his family friction with only brother Bobby, the great Sam Elliott. So there you go, Sam Elliott's playing his brother, and it weighs on his heart heavy. Things change when Ali, who's played by Lady Gaga, captures his heart along the way. The two get to know each other in an intimate way as passion becomes love. Still, the love is not without struggle and heartache as Ali becomes famous and well-known while Jackson's music and personal life both take a downward path with alcoholism, as he just can't escape his dark shadows. It's like you as the viewer could see the tragedy coming all along. It's an overall entertaining film with fine and beautiful music. In the on-screen chemistry between Bradley and Gaga is in top-notch form, as clearly this is one love drama to see that showcases the rise of fame and stardom, also while showing a grim personal downfall. So reading those reviews, two or three of them said it's an absolute 10 out of 10, they'd recommend it to anyone. And then someone else gave it an 8, so it wasn't the best to him, but he thought it was a good watch. So that's basically Star Is Born, you know, Bradley Cooper, Lady Gaga, the audience. But I think the critics have been giving it pretty good reviews. So let's go over to Metacritic, and you've got 100, The Guardian says. They say for one star to get an award, a handful of defeated nominees have to swallow their pain as the spotlight moves away from them. For one star to deliver the shock of the new, another one has to receive the shock of the old. A Star Is Born turns that transaction into a love story And the Telegraph has also gave it 100. They said that the story of A Star Is Born may be as old as show business, but it is also electrifyingly fresh, a well-known melody given vivid, searching new force. And Variety have said, they also gave it a 100, by the way. They said that Cooper has made a jaggedly tender love story that never goes over the top, and it's an operatic movie that dares to be quiet. And the Rap have gave it a 90. They said that Cooper and Lady Gaga are dynamite together. This is a story that lives and dies by the central relationship and the instant chemistry that must blossom between them. And these two have it in spades. So reading that, I think, you know, they've done justice on a classic. They've remaked it perfectly. I can't say that for sure. I haven't seen it. But my thoughts is, you know, it looks like that they're actually doing good acting together. And I haven't really seen Lady Gaga act. I know she's been in the American Horror Stories, which I have not seen. Not really interested in them. But, you know, still, it does look like an interesting watch. And I have watched lots of stuff of Bradley Cooper around the years. And he's made some good films over the years. And then he's made some flops. But it really depends. It looks like that he's done justice on the classic, as I was saying. So A Star Is Born, I'm thinking that I might not see it straight away. I might see something else first, but I will probably be seeing this at the movies, and I'll hope that I enjoy it. I really hope I'll enjoy it. So I'm just thinking, there's many things on, but haven't been to the cinema. I've been a couple of times, but I haven't seen some of those recent releases. I saw Venom, and I didn't get to see Bad Times at the El Royale yet, but I remember last week that I did tell you about it, and don't really have to go on about that again, because you've already heard it. And you've heard about Venom. Well, I did review it last week. It's expected that Chris Hemsworth's just hilarious in it, so I really think that'll be exciting. And First Man, well, that looks pretty amazing. Ryan Gosling, Claire Foy, Jason Clarke.
These are extraordinary times, and we face an extraordinary challenge. The dramatic achievements in space which occurred in recent weeks should have made clear to us all the impact of this adventure on the minds of men everywhere. Now it is time to take longer strides, time for a great new American enterprise. Time for this nation to take a clearly leading role in space achievement, which in many ways may hold the key to our future on Earth. I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
Set sail on this new sea because there is new knowledge to be gained. Can we help decide whether this new ocean will be a sea of peace or a new terrifying theater of war? But why, some say, the moon? Why climb the highest mountain? We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
not sure if I did talk about that last week. I may have missed that. Well, anyway, I think I should talk about it. Well, First Man, it's, you know, it's a biography. It's basically a look at the life of the astronaut Neil Armstrong. And it's about the space mission, the legendary space mission that led him to become the first man to walk on the moon on July 20th, 1969. So that was ages ago. So it looks like, you know, if you want a musical, you go to A Star Is Born. If you're more of a space fanatic or a history biography fanatic, you go to First Man. So basically, First Man, that's basically the story. It's directed by Damien Chazelle. Now, I'm thinking he has directed a couple of things. He actually directed La La Land. I actually didn't know that. So he's gone on from a musical to a space biography. That's actually quite interesting. La La Land was mixed reviews, I remember, when it came out. Some people really liked it. Some people could not stand it. Some people just thought it was okay. But Whiplash got some pretty rave reviews, I remember, with Miles Teller. Now, screenplay is by Josh Singer. I think he's been a part of some memorable things. He wrote the movie The Post last year. Now, that was pretty interesting. Tom Hanks and Meryl Streep, they put on some great performances. And he wrote Spotlight and The Fifth Estate and The West Wing. It's based on the book by James R. Hansen. That's First Man, by the way. And, well, the cast, you've got the cast in First Man, it's pretty simple. You got Claire Foy, who plays Janet Armstrong. Recently, I know that Claire Foy, lots of people have been speaking about her because of The Crown on Netflix, where she plays Queen Elizabeth II. And apparently it's expected to be very good, by the way. And I can tell you that I remember seeing the trailers for First Man, and I've got to say that whenever you see Claire Foy, you can tell that she's doing exceptional acting in First Man. And, you know, she'll be in The Girl in the Spider's Web as well. And she was in Insane, and, you know, she's been in massive films over the last couple of 2 years or something like that. Yeah, so, you know, you also got Ryan Gosling in First Man. Well, he plays Neil Armstrong. And we haven't seen him since Blade Runner 2049. So it's pretty interesting to see him again. To see him after a while. After a big break or from acting. But in First Man, it looks like that he's also doing some great acting here, you know. He knows how to act, he doesn't. He's a good actor. And the third actor you got here, Jason Clarke. We have seen him in Zero Dark Thirty, Terminator, Everest, I think we... Chappaquiddick earlier this year, Winchester, is expected to be in Serenity as well, a new film coming out later this year. But you can also tell by the trailer, I think that Jason Clarke's also doing some great acting here. You know, he knows how to act, he does great performances, and I think Chappaquiddick, he's done a great performance there as well, but I actually didn't get to see that, but wouldn't mind checking it out eventually. And it's good to see that, you know, what Pablo Schreiber, he's had an exceptional year. He started off the year with a bang with Den of Thieves, which I really enjoyed his performance in there. You know, it was just an entertaining film. I enjoyed that one, where the remake of Heat, sort of. And, you know, he's also in Skyscraper. He did a okay performance there, but nah, Den of Thieves, he was much better. And First Man, he'll be even better. So, be good to see First Man, to see Pablo Schreiber's performance. And in here, you've also got Kyle Chandler. We saw him early in the year in Game Night. I don't think I've seen him in anything before Game Night. He's basically... yeah, two movies this year, and then he goes into Godzilla King of the Monsters, so it'll be good to see him there. But First Man, it's just everyone will be doing great acting there. He's been nominated for Oscars and everything, so wouldn't be surprised about that at all. So I'm interested to see, you know. First Man, I've heard someone was saying that they saw it, or I saw a Facebook post or a review. It seemed like he enjoyed it. You know, First Man's got some great actors, and the audience, I think they've been given, it might be, I think the audience have been saying it's sort of not as good as the critics have been saying. Like, the critics have been saying more great things, but the audience is just like, you know, it's good, but it's not great. So... The Dirty Chords have given it an 8 out of 10. This is the audience, so. They said a lot more than just a standard biopic. So it's based on the book First Man, The Life of Neil A. Armstrong by James Hansen. And director Damien Chazelle and writer Josh Singer took the chronicle of an American triumph and empathized on a personal story behind it. Through Armstrong's stance, the film makes a clear point. Determination, struggle, sacrifice, and most of all failure are key ingredients to someone's eventual success. But in order to achieve success, you've got to risk everything. Success is never granted. So he said that First Man is one of those biopics where you know what is about to happen, but can't help because you get caught up in the rising suspense of its great scenes. At their most exciting, these scenes reach a very satisfying climax and rewarding the audience's patience. Directing and cinematography deserve every accolade they have gotten so far. Another one has said Bob Z, MCISHL, which is a user, and he said that a user review, and he gave it a 7 out of 10, and he said, good, not great. He said, I saw this movie at a sneak preview. I had high expectations given the hype, but sadly, this was no the right stuff. The problem may lie in the main character of which the movie's based on, Neil Armstrong. He is portrayed as a colourful technocrat who is somewhat cold to his family. You know, the movie focuses mainly on his family, relationships, and the landing on the moon is somewhat secondary. Therefore, the movie lacks a lot of drama. This is unfortunate since Armstrong had a very charmed life as a fighter pilot, test pilot, and astronaut even. The movie covers three of his serious incidents while flying, and he had at least three more that could have been covered in a mini-series. The main characters all suffer from superficial once-overs. The astronauts were all household names that you wouldn't know it from this movie. The movie also had a hard time capturing just how terrifying some of the events were. Apollo 13 did a far better job of recounting the terror of the flight. Claire Foy's the wife was okay, but she also had a degree of coldness about her. The movie also glosses over the misplaced disdain military pilots had for their civilian Sylvian counterparts. And he said by the end of the career, you know, he flew over 200 different aircrafts. He was a giant. I think the movie should have brought that out. Another person, Blu-ray addict AU, said he gave it a 9 out of 10. He said, from utterly terrifying space flight to raw emotional gut punch, First Man is stellar. So First Man, directed by Damien Chazelle, opens up with that I could only describe as an absolutely terrifying look at what it would be like to be a test pilot in the 60s. You hear every nut and bolt warping and you feel every massive unnerving vibration for what felt like an eternity. This set the tone for the rest of the film and signaled that we were in for one hell of a ride. And yet First Man is not just a bunch of planes and rockets flying around. In fact, the entire film is more focused on Neil Armstrong, Ryan Gosling, and how all of these events leading up to the moon landing affected him, especially his mental state. This is where the film absolutely excels, by chronicling his journey from test pilot all the way to Apollo and losing friends across along the way. Gosling and Claire Foy push out really stellar performances here, and the relationship between the two seems very, very plausible, and there is a lot of very emotionally charged scenes between them throughout. The supporting cast is packed to the brim with recognizable faces too, and a standout for me was Jason Clarke's performance as Ed White, the first American to EVA in space, who at first I thought I really wasn't going to like the character, but by the midpoint of the film, I was sold. One of the qualities of First Man that I noticed almost instantly was the very unique cinematography, which most of the time uses handheld medium to long telephoto shots, creating a very intimate and raw look to the images on screen. The other main quality visually is the fact that most of the film was shot with 2 perf Technoscope film, which gives a very organic vintage look. Usually I'd take issue with a lower resolution stock for a film like this, but here it really fits in the overall aesthetics. In First Man, we do get some ridiculously stellar space sequences. The way they are edited and shot create almost pure dread. In fact, the only time I have felt this on edge was when I saw Gravity for the first time. It is that bloody good. Production design's fantastic. Of course, when we get to the Apollo sequences, the images on screen are graceful and an utterly mesmerizing experience from impeccably shot terrifying space flight to absolute gut-wrenching heartbreak. First Man is something to be seen on the biggest screen possible with the loudest sound. I highly recommend this film, and the moment this comes out in Ultra HD, you can be sure I'll be there day one. Thanks to Universal Pictures Australia for the invite to the premiere. So would you look at that? That review was pretty well written. I gotta say that he really enjoyed it. And I gotta say that I think I enjoyed a lot too. You know, the trailers, they seemed really exceptional, and the movie will be even better. I know that the reviews, well, the critic reviews, I think some of them been getting it, giving them some great reviews. I know that Variety gave it 100. They said, after seeing First Man, it's doubtful you'll think about spaceflight or Armstrong's historic walk in quite the same way. You'll know more deeply how it happened, what it meant and what it was, and why its mystery more than ever still lingers. The Film Stage gave it a 91. They said, in its tragic undertones, complex psychological advice, and claustrophobic visuals, First Man stands out in both content and form as a remarkable jaw-dropping departure from anything Chazelle has previously made. The Hollywood Reporter has gave it a 90. It said, "It's a credit to the filmmakers and to lead actor Ryan Gosling's thoughtfully internalized performance as Neil Armstrong that this sober, contemplative picture has emotional involvement, visceral tension, and yes, even suspense, in addition to stunning technical craft." The Wrap has gave it an 85. They said, "Overall, it's an impressively mounted film, from the seamless visual effects to the score by Justin Hurwitz, which is flexible enough to accentuate both the film's tension and its earthbound humanity, to the always exquisite editing by Tom Cross, who actually edited Whiplash, which was directed by the same director, and which plays a key role in establishing the characters, the stakes, and even the passage of time." So I've got to admit, my thoughts on that, I've heard that one reviewer said that it's the best cinematography since Interstellar. You've just got to say that's just amazing. You know, it looks like, obviously I don't know much of the story. I know some, but after seeing First Man, I bet that I'll learn more about the mission and it'll be a good educational lesson, meaning a great history lesson. You know, I just can't wait to see it. It's just one of those impossible journeys to the moon, and you know, the acting, Claire Foy, Ryan Gosling, Jason Clarke, Kyle Chandler, just all of them will create star-packed performances, you know, powerful performances, and just can't wait to see it. You know, in my opinion, it'll be better than Venom, because that was pretty slow, but still exciting. But, you know, First Man will just top that. It just will. I mean, I'm just thinking, anything else to cover? Any other new films? I think we have some pretty interesting films out, but actually, let's talk about Avinda Samatha Vira Raghava.
వేసంగి గొంతులో దిగితే ఎట్టుంటుందో తెలుసా? మచ్చల పులి ముఖం మీద గాండ్రిస్తే ఎట్టుంటుందో తెలుసా? మట్టి తుఫాన్ చెవిలో మోగితే ఎట్టుంటుందో తెలుసా? కంటపడ్డావా? కనికరిస్తానేమో. ఎంటపడ్డానా? నరికేస్తావో బా.
So, this is a new Indian film, and I haven't heard much about it, but apparently it's been smashing records in Australia and been smashing records worldwide, like in America, for example. So, the movie, it's about two villages in Ralasima, Lagudi and Komadi are engaged in a feud for decades, led by Basi Reddy and Napa Reddy, respectively. Son of Napa Reddy, Vira Raghava returns from London after completing his education, and it's about a young scion of a powerful family with a long history of violence that decides to put an end to the bloodshed, which leads him to a path of self-discovery. So it's an action drama. It's from director Trivikram Shrivans. So he's a Telugu director. Now, I've got to admit, I have not seen any of his other work, but I hope to see this one. He also written the screenplay for it as well. So the actors, you've got N.T. Rama Rao Jr. Sorry, but I haven't heard of him, but I've got to admit that I have seen the trailer for it, and I think this put in an interesting performance, a good performance. So he plays Veera Raghava Reddy. And there's also Pooja Hegde, who actually has worked in Indian cinema, so I think I actually recognise her. I hope that I get to see it, because she starred with Hrithik Roshan in the... It was like Jodha Akbar, but it was sort of different. It was one of those... Like, you know, one of those epic movies, epic adventures. And Hrithik Roshan, he put a great performance. I saw it 2-3 years ago. And so she mainly works in Telugu cinema. But for some reason, she was in one Bollywood film, which was Mohenjo-daro. And that's where I know her from. So I'd be happy to see this one, to see her again. I mean, she did put a great performance into that, so it'll be good to see her again. And yeah, I've been seeing on Facebook this film, like, it's just been breaking records everywhere. And the thing is, I would like to see some more Telugu films. I haven't, you know, obviously I've seen many, many Bollywood films, but I'm interested to check out Telugu cinema as well. Why not? I mean... I have no problem doing that. I actually did see a Tamil film last year, which was Spider with Mahesh Babu. Gotta admit, it was pretty exciting. It was, it had holes here and there, but it was an interesting type of story, actually. And starring Rakul Preet Singh, who was in a Bollywood film, which was Ayari with Siddharth Malhotra. So the audience, now, I haven't really read reviews on here, but it'll be interesting to see what they think of it. So someone gave it 10 out of 10, CAC 717708. He said... The movie main basic theme is how to change the faction people into peace. It doesn't even make sense what he said there. Okay, here's a good review. Prudiv Gotapati has gave it a 9 out of 10. He said that Junior NTR bags super hit reports in Trivikram's direction. JRNTR has impressed everyone with his amazing acting, which is the highlight of a Aravinda Sametha. NTR JR dialogue, modulation, emotions, and action blocks are the highlights of this film. Director Trivikram stuck to the core point throughout the film without any subplots or deviations. An action block in first 20 minutes of the film. Trivikram has executed it in style, and the music and Batrick score by S.S. Trabham are very good. The positives are his performance, the writing is excellent in many scenes, and the first 20 minutes of the film, and the climax in the second half starring Jagapathy Babu's performance. Another one's gave it a 10 out of 10. They said the acting, the dance, and relations in movie is fantastic. The values for women is given importance by a man shown in this, the movie, and the dialogues are beautiful. Rupunjaya Chaudhary, I think that's could be a woman, and she said it's a speechless woman, a speechless movie. So another one's gave it a 10 out of 10, Danger Prakash, and he said 100% trivia come mark, a complete action family drama. This is all about the things about a war after a war. Base concept is everyone winning a war on his one day, but the only one who can stop the war is the real hero. Trivicum 100% succeeded on the conveyance of the same content. All key roles are performed well. NTR carried his base emotion throughout the movie. Don't expect lots of comedy from Sunil Karakta. He's not a comedian in the film, but he's a good supporting role. Jagapathy Vavu, Vinalism seems like Simha catheterization. Never give up. Fights could be different. First fight composition looks like Kaleja dust fight and Jalsa villain introduction fight. It's a pace of Vasool movie. 100% Trivika mark. No logic missing this time. Another blockbuster from Tarek Anna, Devi Seti Sivakumadi. First 30 minutes and the last 30 minutes are main aspects of the Avinda Sametha Veera Raghava. Hats off to Trikram. Hats to Jagu by SS Taman Music. So yeah, it's an interesting review. Now, I know the critics, some of them have liked it, some of them hated it. My thoughts on Avinda Sametha Veera Raghava. Gotta admit that when I saw the trailer, you know, it seems like this hero, he's put in a good performance. You know, you can tell he's a nice guy, but, you know, he gets angry also. You know, he's probably a family man as well. It's good to see. You know, you must have a relationship with a girl as well, because it's Indian cinema, you know, it has to have a girl and a boy love story, you know, but I don't think they'll be stretched out much. It's mostly an action drama. They won't go into subplots, as they were saying. You know, he just appears to put in amazing performances in his acting, just, you know, action-packed stuff like Bahubali, which was dubbed into Hindi, but, you know, his expressions, you can tell that he's putting work into it, you know? You can tell that he's putting effort into it, and I can just see that by the trailer alone. So, yeah, that's Avinda Sametha Raghava. So, that's... Basically, I would recommend people to check it out, but hopefully I get the chance to see it, because I think it's not really playing much anymore. So I just hope that I might actually get the chance to see it, because it seems like it will be a powerful film with great action, some comedy, you know, romance and masala cinema, but apparently very well done masala cinema, which is always good to see. Now, the Johnny English is still out, by the way. Apparently it's been getting some good response. I actually haven't seen it yet, but I'm planning to see it soon, because I really did like the first two. And it's just there's been some other things out, so I haven't got the chance to see it yet. So, you know, Johnny English Strikes Again is the third installment in the Johnny English series. We started off with the first Johnny English in, I think it was 2003. And then we got Johnny English Reborn in 2011. And now we have Johnny English Strikes Again in 2018.
I'm not sure I've ever met a man quite like you.
You haven't.
We have a problem.
Good. Virtual reality.
It's completely immersive and some people lose track of their surroundings.
That's not gonna happen.
Can I just ask, what is wrong with you? Did you or did you not burn the Côte du Roc restaurant to the ground? And did you fire a missile at a peloton of French cyclists?
Well...
Before commandeering an open-top bus and tossing the tour guide off the top deck?
Gotta admit, it'll be a great entertaining movie. So I think the story about this one, it revolves on a cyber attack. And it's basically revealing the identity of all the active undercover agents in Britain. So Johnny English is forced to come out of retirement to find the mastermind hacker. So Johnny English must overcome the challenges of modern technology to make this mission a success. That will be funny to see Johnny English dealing with technology problems, you know. He's not smart in that area. You know, he's more of an old-fashioned guy. He's not into that tech type of stuff, so it'll be interesting to see that. Now, it's directed by David Kerr. Now, I think David Kerr, he's directed mostly TV shows. I don't think he's directed a feature film, so it could be his first feature film if I'm... Yeah, he's worked on TV films, but... they're not memorable. So that's basically him. But it's the screenplay's from, I think, the same story. Who wrote Johnny English Reborn and the first Johnny English. And it's actually from the writer of Twins, which is that, you know, it's quite funny that Arnold Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito comedy. And, the cast in here, you've got Rowan Atkinson. And he's playing Johnny English, you know. He does justice to this character. He's just, you know, he puts hard work in there. He's a funny type of guy, you know, Mr. Bean and everything. He's always putting great work. And also you got Olga Korolenko. She was in Oblivion, she's been in The November Man, Hitman, Quantum of Solace. I know her, I've seen her a couple of times. Emma Thompson's also in here, playing the Prime Minister. Now, you know, I've seen her in Love Actually, Saving Mr. Banks. I think she was also in Beauty and the Beast, Bridget Jones' Baby. She's been in a couple of things like that. Well, the audience have been given it good reviews. So David Dunn, he said, it's a hilarious movie. He said, I enjoyed the first two Johnny English outings. Admittedly, I wasn't expecting the latest adventure to be anywhere near good as due to Johnny being that bit older. But he still has that inimitable magic to appreciate these movies. It is suggested that your brain's turned off and the reality is suspended for the duration. It's all incredibly silly and an unashamed spoof of Bond films. If you can do that, then you'll love this film. This movie. I have not laughed so much in years. That's an interesting review. 10 out of 10, hilarious movie, he said. Alright, here's another 10 out of 10 review. 4-0 written or lover it. 96331. Don't know what name that is, but he gave it a 10 out of 10 and he said, Atkinson is brilliant. One of the funniest things I've seen in years. Take it for what it is. It's not meant to be a complex and compellingly written story. It's meant to entertain and make people laugh. And it did that every single minute. This movie does not disappoint at all. Ignore any bad reviews and go and watch it. See for yourself how fantastic Rowan Atkinson is. And the cinema were in stitches. my dad, admittedly a massive Johnny English fan, complained that his face hurt from all the laughing that he did. That just says it all. Just to have a great night out in good company with this hilarious film, you would not be disappointed. So, that's an actually good review. Someone else, they gave it a 7 out of 10. Vikesh said it enjoyable and hilarious, if eventually exhausting and unmemorable. Johnny English Strikes Again's a perfectly enjoyable and hilarious, if eventually exhausting and unmemorable action comedy. You get exactly what you expect. This time around, a cyber attack reveals all Britain undercover agents, all British undercover agents. So the MI7 rely on retired agent Johnny English to discover who the villain is and to stop him or her. The plot is by the numbers and the guess the villain trope is mind-numbingly predictable. But let's be honest, we don't watch a Johnny English film to be bothered by plot. Every scene contains some slapstick shenanigans. This is the film's strength as well as its archives heel. There are segments in the film such as a scene in a French restaurant and an extended sequence involving virtual reality, as well as the final act, which are laugh out loud funny. Those expecting raunchy humour will be disappointed, as there is none of that. All the humour is slapstick and family friendly. However, every scene has humour in it, and so there is no breathing space to take in the jokes that are being hurled at you. This is where the film suffers. There is only one scene in the entire film which has any memorance of dramatic weight. This is thanks to the talent of Emma Thompson, who plays the Prime Minister. Overall, you know what you're expecting with this film. It has non-stop slapstick humour, most of which land. A little bit more weight and space between humour would have improved this film dramatically and made the comedy more memorable. The theatre I watched in was full from A row to Z, and the theatre and the audience was clapping, cheering and laughing the entire time. The atmosphere enhanced my film-going experience. My recommendation is to watch it once in theatres. The film is light and enjoyable throughout its run time, even if you forget it afterwards. You know, so apparently it's, you know, it's a good watch at the movies. Seems like it's an exciting type of film. I don't think you'll be disappointed by it at all. It seems like it's a pretty smart film. Now let's talk about some other things now. I was going to talk about Badayo. Now, yeah, it's not actually released yet, but it releases tomorrow.
Mummy, theek hai?
Haan, main isliye to bulaya tum log ko yahan pe. To doctor ne kahi ki mehmaan aan wala ghar
mein. Mehmaan? Main apni jagah kisi ko dene ka papa? Bata diya maine aapko.
Chhota mehmaan.
मम्मी प्रेग्नेंट है मेरी
मम्मी मतलब तेरी मम्मी
ये तो क्या तेरी मम्मी
शी इज व्हाट कैसे
आई थिंक जैसे होता है वैसे
अब क्या होगा रे प्यारे खुशियां ही जब किक मारे जाए कहां मुंह लेकर जी
हो गया
हैं
अरे फिर से हो गया
जय रंग
कौशिक साहब
शक्ल से तो बड़े शरीफ लगते हैं
सबसे पहले तो नूं जानना है मुझे टाइम कब मिल गया तुझे अब सब समझ आ रही क्यों बहू का बदन टूटा करे है रोज सुबह
मारी थी मिस कॉल ही लेकिन हो गया
गुस्सा थूक दे तेरे चेहरे पे ना बिल्कुल ना सुहाता ये
एक तो तुम ऐसी बातें करो मती इन्हीं सब बातों का नतीजा है यो
क्या होगा
तू ही बता यार ये भी कोई मम्मी पापा के करने की चीज है क्या
नहीं नहीं नहीं, नहीं, नहीं।
What? Do you find it embarrassing कि तेरे mom dad sex करते हैं?
तेरी mummy pregnant होती ना, फिर देखता मैं।
मेरी mummy pregnant होती तो और भी बड़ी problem होती यार।
देखा?
पापा नहीं है ना मेरे।
I'm not saying that Nakul's a bad guy. अच्छा लड़का है वो।
You know his family is a circus. I don't want to buy tickets to.
चिटकनी ना लगेगी अब से।
मारी थी miss call ही लेकिन हो गया answer।
Light बंद कर दियो।
आपका भी बेबी गुड वेरी गुड करेक्ट एज है आपका
नकुल चल बेटा
हाँ मम्मी
From the director Amit Ravindranath Sharma, and actually hasn't directed like a comedy type film. His last film he directed was Teva with Arjun Kapoor and Sonika Sinha and Manoj Bajpayee. He does some great films, but it would be good to see what he does in it. Teva was a pretty exciting action adventure, but it'll be interesting to see how he changes, you know, the type of film. The screenplay and dialogues by Akshat Giladai. It's actually his first time he's written. So it's his first written appearance in the film industry. So it's good to see what he'll do, and I've got to admit the trailer's pretty funny. It's pretty hilarious, and I actually enjoyed it. I think I'll enjoy the dialogues in there. Seems to be some memorable dialogues, and the story's very creative as well. And he's not just the only person doing the story. They've also got Jyoti Kapoor. And she actually wrote the story for Dawat-e-Ishq. Now that was that was actually a good film with Aditya Roy Kapoor and Paniti Chopra and also Anupam Kher. Now that wasn't a bad film at all. But Shanatan U Srivastava also wrote the story and. She wrote the story for Teva, so she's coming back for Badayo. It'll be good to see what happens there. Now the acting. Well, the main actor, you've got Anushman Khurana. Now I've seen some of his films, but I haven't seen all of them. His most recent thing would be it's actually out now, but it's. Not showing at many places anymore. It was sort of a limited release, but with Radhika Apte, who's in almost every Netflix Indian film or TV series. You could just search her up and she's in about 10 to 12 of them, I've got to say. But Under Dunan, I've been hearing that it's been getting some exceptional reviews, but we're not here to talk about that. We're here to talk about Badayo. But he also has been in Barely Ki Burfi, and I saw that on Netflix, and I've got to admit it was quite funny. Vicky Dona, I think I may have seen it a couple of years ago. Mary Piari Bundi, I didn't see it, but I hope to see it one time. Eventually, one day I might get the chance to see it. You know, but Badayo, it's... So the talk about the movie, it's basically the plot is about a man faces embarrassment in the society when he finds out his mother is pregnant. So that would just be hilarious. Unfortunately, I can't give you audience or any reviews because it comes out tomorrow. But my thoughts is just watch the trailer. It's just a funny film, and you can put on the English subtitles as well, so you'll understand the dialogues. I gotta admit, it's something creative. I've never seen anything like it, and it'll be different to Teva. So I'm just surprised it's the same director who's worked on it. You know, it's just a bit surprising to me, but it's not a bad thing. Alright, so the next film I wanted to talk about is Namaste England.
लाला जी दो घंटे में आ रहे हैं तब तक अपनी सेटिंग कर लो
जसमीत जी हमारे इश्क की इनॉग्रेशन की जाए
दादाजी पैरी पौना वो मेरे को लड़के वाले देखने आ रहे हैं तो आप जसमीत को भेज देते तो
दादाजी
मेरे को लड़के वाले आ रहे हैं देखने के लिए
पंजाब में इतने लड़के नहीं जितनी बार तूने बहाना यूज किया शर्म नहीं ये तो ऐसे गले ना मिलाकर तुझे पता नहीं मेरे दिल में कैसे 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 ख्याल आते हैं इसके अंदर की तो जादुई शक्तियां जाग गई है आज तू अपनी सारी शक्तियां गवा देगा
भी नहीं किया
है तुमने शादी के 1.5 साल होते ही ब्रश करने के बाद चलो हाँ 3 साल होते नहाने के बाद शुरू कर दो
तुझे पता है ना यहाँ लड़कियों को कुछ करने की आजादी नहीं है
तुम लड़कियों का समझ में नहीं आता मुझे
लड़कियों का समझ नहीं आता क्योंकि लड़कियों को समझा नहीं जाता
जसमीत हम कहाँ रहते हैं उससे फर्क नहीं पड़ता हम किसके साथ रहते हैं और वो हमें कितना प्यार करता है फर्क इससे पड़ता है
तुम मुझे मेरी आजादी यहीं दिला दो नहीं जाती पर हम और कोई समझे ना समझे तुम जरूर समझोगे कि मैं लंदन क्यों चली गई
लंदन जाना है लीगल इलीगल सब चलेगा पहली बार एक बीवी का अफेयर किसी आदमी के साथ नहीं एक शहर के साथ देखा है
सबकी नजरों में गिरकर इतनी दूर मैं यहाँ आई हूँ अब मैं वापस नहीं जा सकती परम
अभी भी मैं तो यहाँ पे आके एक बार नहाया भी
हूँ मंजिल बहुत करीब है परम कल तक रुक जाओ
आज एक दूसरे के साथ बुरा करना ये सोच के कि इससे हमारा कल अच्छा होगा इससे बड़ी बेवकूफी इस दुनिया में नहीं हो सकती जसमीत
आज के जमाने में प्यार शादी कोई वैल्यू ही नहीं है
दुनिया आज भी एक ही चीज पे कायम है जिसकी वजह से दुनिया कायम है प्यार तेरे लिए हर पल
रहूं तेरे लिए Now it's a remake of Namaste London and it's from the same director who made Namaste London with Akshay Kumar. So it'll be interesting to see, you know, because he knows, because he's the one who created it, he will be able to create something great again. So we hope that he will. And walked the race against time. I saw that years ago, and he also was a director of that. So on the writing, you've got Suresh Nair, and so Suresh Nair, he has written some films like Airlift. He wrote the screenplay for Airlift, and that was just a powerful, dramatic film, you know? Akshay Kumar, he makes those history-based films, and he does great work on them. He does justice on them. He's just... it's just powerful, the acting he did in that. It was just exceptional film. It's also from the screenplay of Bang Bang and Namaste London. The Singer's King as well. Now the cast in here, you've got the main actor, Arjun Kapoor. Now he's... I gotta admit, I do enjoy him when he's on screen. He's a good actor. And he's been in films like Two States and Half Girlfriend, which I unfortunately haven't seen, but I'm hoping to see them soon. But I did see Gunde, and he starred in that, with Ranveer Singh. Now, there was some of these people who said, you know, it was sort of not historically accurate, so people gave it a hard time, but it was entertaining, but you know, it wasn't the best, I don't think. But Mubarak Khan with Anil Kapoor and Arjun Kapoor and Alina De Cruz and Aditya Shetty. Now I did enjoy that too, and Arjun Kapoor was in that. And that was just it was a movie about identical twin brothers, Arjun Kapoor and Sir Karan and Charan. They play each other. They're both played by Arjun Kapoor. You know, one lives in London, one was raised in Punjab. One is street smart and calculating, one is simple and honest. You know, it's just one of those films, and it was quite funny, and it had some memorable songs, so it was worth it. And probably Key and Ka as well. Who remembers that song? Aayil te nache ta tu da tu bari nache. You know, that was a catchy song. Yo yo honey sing. You know, it was good. But Key and Ka was a nice film. I enjoyed it. It was an interesting, you know, also original film with Kareena Kapoor and Arjun Kapoor. And I think the best performance of him, everyone says it's Aurangzeb. It is, apparently he just did a powerful role. I've seen some of the songs. Unfortunately, I haven't seen the film, but I'm hoping to see it really, really soon. It also has Rishi Kapoor. It just seems like one of those powerful stories. And it's set in Gurgaon as well. It's about criminal and crime. So I think that Arjun Kapoor is just, he'll be good in this. And Baniti Chopra, I think, she's not bad either. I would have seen her in Dishum. She played a parent's song in there. And Kill Dil, Dawat-e-Ishq, Ladies vs. Ricky Ball, a couple of things like that. Unfortunately, I can't give you reviews either because it releases tomorrow. And that is because releasing, I think it was saying that it's releasing in Dashera. Dashera must be tomorrow then. It'll be interesting to see it. You know, you'll get to see the colourful world of India. You'll get to see the city of England. It will be, not the city, I mean, you'll be able to see the England itself. It'll be interesting to see that. I'm not sure if there's thing that basically covers it. There's not really much else to talk about. I've done a pretty full show. I think it's time to finish 2Sweet movie reviews. I'll see you next week.